I'm not going to read the scripture yet. I'm going to share that actually within the message this evening. The older I get, and as my parents are still living, I find out that my dad is the gift that just keeps on giving. My dad, because of the weather and some other things going on, had shared with me about a day or so ago and then confirmed it last night that he wasn't going to be able to be here to share the message. So today I whipped something up, and I hope what I whipped up for you tonight God will use in a way that will work on each of our hearts. One of the blessings I had growing up is every year during Thanksgiving, at minimum, we would go for that week and we would see my mom's parents, my grandparents on her side. Grandmom and Granddad Hunt lived in Gretna, Virginia, about 20 miles almost to the North Carolina line. So it was in deep Virginia, in the deep mountains. Took you a while to get there. Red clay was in the ground up in those mountains. Many of the roads by the time you got there were dirt. And Granddad owned a number of country stores. His main store, though, was right there where my mom's whole family lived on the same road. She was the only one that has ever left the mountain, if you say it that way. And my granddad was such a gracious man. And people from all around would come to his store. And back then, he would do everything. He'd have his butcher apron on, and he'd be cutting the beef in the back. And he would do everything that you can imagine. But I remember the custom we had, and I was about 6 years of age, so I had a 10-year-old brother, a 12-year-old sister, a 14-year-old sister. They were older than me. My youngest brother was just in the process of being born. And the custom always was, is before we left, my granddad would give us a little brown bag and let us walk through the store and, get a good bag of candy for free. And then we would take that home on the ride. Mom and Dad would usually take the bags from us and every once in a while, give us a little bit from our bag. Well, one year we finally got to that point where that year when I was six of getting the bag, and my granddad said to me, "Show me your pockets." And so reluctantly I pulled out my pockets, and both pockets had a bunch of candy that I had already put in them from an hour or so earlier. Granddad then took the candy back from me. My two sisters and my brother, they got all bags of candy, and that year I didn't. Got put in the car, drove the whole way home. Of course, my older brothers and sisters, they were very merciful towards me. They never said, "See, I have candy," or, or in their stomach, "Oh, it tastes so good," all those types of things. And I learned my lesson all the way home, all 6 hours back to Joppa. But, when I think about in my early life there, when I stole some things, when I did clearly what wasn't right, when I took something that wasn't mine, I also know that I'm not the only one who has done such things. I looked up some statistics. Annually, stolen from U.S. businesses by employees each year, annually, $50 billion worth is stolen from businesses by their employees. The percent of annual revenue lost by theft from employees is 7%. The percent of employees who have stolen at least once from their employer, 75%. 3 out of 4. Someone who's stolen twice from their employer, 38%. We have approximately 27 million shoplifters. 1 in every 11 people have shoplifted. 25% of those are kids. 75% are adults. And those adults say they started, over 60% of them say they started shoplifting when they were kids. And usually shoplifters buy something at the same time that they're stealing something. And the average is somewhere between $2 and $200 every time they take something. Did you know last year over 700,000 motor vehicles were stolen nationwide? We're told that every 44 seconds a car is stolen. You know the number one car that's stolen? A Honda Accord. So if you got that, you better be careful, okay? Honda Accord. Our scripture tonight is about Mary anointing the feet of Jesus with an expensive perfume. And in this story, we have two main characters. The first character in the story is Mary. Let me read a few verses. 6 days before the Passover, Jesus came to Bethany, where Lazarus lived, whom Jesus had raised from the dead. Now we know Lazarus was one of the closest friends that Jesus had. He visited Mary and Martha in Lazarus' house, who were brothers and sisters, often. Seemed like during his ministry, that's a place where he would go to kind of regroup and just let his hair down and relax a little bit. We know that Jesus wept over Lazarus' death. We know that Jesus raised him from the dead after being in the tomb for 4 days. This is after that event. Verse 2, here a dinner was given in Jesus' honor. Martha served while Lazarus was among those reclining at the table with Jesus. So they were in close fellowship with each other. Right? Close fellowship here. Then Mary took about a pint of pure nard, an expensive perfume. Now this is a fragrant ointment that we know that was most likely that it was imported from the east, that it came from the mountains, the hills of India. That's where this was imported from in those days. And it was a very high-priced anointing oil. Later on in the scripture, it says that it's projected that this anointing oil that she had was worth 1 year's wage. Imagine that. 1 year's wage was in this bottle. Okay? So it's the most expensive thing that she had, probably the most precious thing that she had in her house. It says she poured it on Jesus' feet and wiped his feet with her hair, and the house was filled with the fragrance of the perfume. Mary is very generous towards Jesus. She gives to Jesus her most prized possession. Now, what would normally, this ointment, it would normally be put on a body of someone who had died. This was normally the ointment that was placed on someone's body when they had died to honor the person who was deceased. Now, why in the world is she doing this? Because Jesus was still alive. What we know is it was a foreshadowing of what was to come. It reminds me of the story about a native village that was discovered in that village that there was a thief amidst all of the village. And so the chief of the village decreed that whoever would be caught stealing, if they would find the person who was stealing, that they would be punished with 15 lashes of the whip upon their back. Well, late one night, the chief was awakened and told that the thief was caught. Now, to his horror, the chief discovered that the thief was his very own grandmother. The villagers began to murmur, curious to know whether the punishment he had put out would then be enforced. But without hesitating, the chief commanded that the 15 lashes be given. But before the whip was swung, the chief then took off his upper garment, and he stood over his grandmother, and he covered her body with his, and he exposed his back instead. You see, Mary seems to have this understanding of Jesus' purpose, not just in life, but that this is Jesus' purpose in death. She knew how much Jesus loved the sinner and what he would do for the sinner. No wonder her faith expressed itself through such a gift of love. So when she anoints Jesus' feet and when she wipes his feet with her hair, she seems to even have a better understanding of what's going on than Jesus' own disciples. She knows that Jesus is going to die. And she knows what his death will mean, not only for her, but for everyone. You see, Mary and Martha seem to be very in tune with Jesus. Remember Martha, after Lazarus had died? And Jesus shows up on the scene. Martha greets Jesus and says, boy, you know, if you would have been here, Jesus, my brother wouldn't have died. And he says to her, you know, your brother isn't going to die. He's going to be raised on the last day. And she says, I know he's going to be raised. But if you would have been here now, and Jesus says, look, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Those who believe in me will not die. Do you believe this? And Martha says, I do. I believe you are the Savior who has come into the world. So Mary and Martha seem to be in tune spiritually with Jesus. Now, Mary's the first character in our story today. The second character is Judas Iscariot, one of Jesus' disciples. Look at verse 4. But one of his disciples, Judas Iscariot, who was later to betray him, he objected, right? He's objecting to what Mary's doing. "Why wasn't this perfume sold and the money given to the poor?" he says. "It was worth a year's wages." He did not say this because he cared about the poor, though. It was because he was a thief, a keeper of the money bag. He used to help himself to what was put in it. We have someone who's on the opposite spectrum here of Mary. Now, what Judas does is he lets Mary have it in a sort of pious way. Right? He puts on a good show for everyone else. And it was a shame, he says, "Mary, boy, what a shame of what you've done. That was such a waste." Judas seems to say to her, "Look, I could have taken that perfume and I could have taken it into town and I could have gotten the highest bidder. You should have donated that money to the ministry of Jesus. And we could have gotten more money for it and we could have brought that money back and we would have given all of that money to the poor. Just think, Mary, how many poor people would have been helped? How many street people, those who needed help with paying their electric bill or their mortgages because they were getting kicked out of their houses? Just think how many people who needed food and clothing and the homeless who needed a shelter and the abused who needed counseling support. The list was endless. What a difference we could have made with that money. We could have been a part of something much greater, Mary." That's what Judas is saying to her. Folks, what a farce. Judas didn't care a lick. He didn't care a lick about the poor, and he didn't care a lick about Jesus. His pious talk was nothing but a cover. Underneath what he said, he was all about helping himself and getting ahead himself at Mary's expense. If she would have given that to him, he not only would have, well, given some money for Jesus and that ministry, but he would have surely pocketed some of it himself. You know, when our money counters take the money back after a service and they take it back and they count the money and then secure it and put it away. I've kidded with the money counters before. Now remember, when you go count that money, remember what the method is: two for you and one for Pastor Paul when you're counting the money out. That's the way it should work. But you see, that's what Judas was doing. Two for Jesus, one for me. Less for Jesus meant more for him. His talk was a front for padding his own bank account. Right? And we know that in the end, he will even betray Jesus for just 30 pieces of silver. Pastor Brent Kuhlman says it this way: Judas will soon make a dastardly deal for cash to betray Jesus into the hands of his enemies that leads directly to Jesus' death. What a fraud. What a big-time seventh commandment breaker. He couldn't care less how much his robbery deeply hurt people. Mary, his fellow disciples, or even Jesus. The seventh commandment: you shall not steal. What does Luther say about it? What does this mean in the small catechism? He says, we should fear and love God so that we do not take our neighbor's money or possessions or get them in a dishonest way, but help our neighbor to improve and protect their possessions and their income. Luther's explanation goes along with the revelation of Scripture and the revelation that comes to us, especially through the teaching of Jesus. We are to help others. We are to serve others. We are to do that instead of thieving and taking advantage of others. Because when we steal from others, it harms and hurts them. It will injure them. As we see through Judas, more for me and less for you at your expense, that is clearly a sin, not only against our neighbor, but it is even a sin against God. And sometimes we do that by what we do. We take advantage of other people, and we do so by living at their expense. I mean, professionally, think about it. Have you ever taken anything from work? At home, do you have a few pencils or a few pens from your workplace? Oh, maybe just a few legal pads here or there, some sticky notes. Nobody will miss them. Business has a bunch of them. How about some file folders, anything like that? You ever take anything home from your business, paper clips, anything else? It's stealing. How about professionally? Maybe you're somebody who gives quotes for your business. When you give a quote to someone, do you go far beyond what's fair and kind of pad your quotes? Well, that's because everybody does it in our business and our field. Or maybe sometimes when you're pressed at home, you're not sure how you're going to make ends meet. You walk into a home, it's a really nice home. Oh, these people can afford it, so you pad up your quote. You take advantage of them so that then you can make ends meet. That's not only a sin against the seventh commandment, it's a sin against the first commandment. Because folks, when we do not trust God to provide for us, and when we start to take that into our own hands, you see, that's a sin. How about when it comes, if you're a salesman? You know, I was always told, I'm sure all car salesmen are bad. I know that. I was told never go buy a car dressed up. Never go buy a car, what, looking like you got any money. Dress down. You don't want them to think that you can afford it. I mean, if you're somebody who's a salesman, a car salesman, do you lift up the price of the car beyond even fairness? Because your goal is really what? I'm going to squeeze as much money out of these people as I can because that means it's more in my pocket. How about personally? Income tax time, right? Right? Don't you love this time of year? When you prepare your income tax, though, do you report all your money? You kind of hedge a little bit here, hide some here, so that you're going to have more in your pocket. And you rationalize, you say, well, the government always takes enough from me. I deserve a little bit back. If I'm going to cut some corners and not report some things, that's okay. I don't know, it's stealing. How about with family? I can't tell you as a minister how many times I've seen family members, right, take from other family members. Sometimes when a mother and a father get older and they need a family member to take care of them, a family member might come in, and all of a sudden, the mom and dad's money starts to disappear, money that in the end should have gone to other family members. One of the children takes it from the other. That's stealing. Or has somebody, when you've been in a store, ever undercharged you? Or maybe it's a bill you get from your insurance company or doctor's office, and they made a mistake. They didn't charge you as much as they should. Do you tell them? Or you're at the register at Old Navy, and maybe they make a mistake, and they don't charge you as much. Or the waitress makes a mistake and doesn't charge you really the way that she should for your bill, and you don't say anything. And I think God gives us the impression in Scripture, not just that stealing is that, but stealing is also when we don't give what we should. And I don't think we think of stealing this way. When we rob people of what they really should have or even be receiving from us. Remember in Malachi, Jesus says, look, you rob me. And the people of God say, how do we rob you? He says, you rob me in tithes and offerings. You're under a curse, your whole nation, because you are robbing me. Bring the whole tithe into the storehouse that there may be food in my house. So what God is saying is when you don't tithe to me or when you don't give to me what's expected and you keep it back for yourself, what's he saying? He says it right in the scripture. You're robbing from me when you don't give me what you should be giving me. We rob other people when we're not giving to them what we should be giving to them. I mean, could it be that a husband steals from his wife when he withholds his love from her or when she withholds her love from him? Or do teenagers steal from their parents when they don't give them honor and respect? Is it not stealing when we do not give the love, the help, the respect, and honor that other people deserve? Things that we can give, but we hold it back and keep it for ourselves? And we need to remember that when we steal, it's also that sin against the first commandment. We're not just sinning against our neighbor, but when we sin, as the commandments reveal, we're sinning against God. And I want to say to you this, if it's whether it's something small or something big, if you're stealing, stop it. Just stop it. And we need to stop it right now. We need to stop taking advantage of other people. We need to stop taking advantage of our family. Stop taking advantage of people we deal with professionally. Stop taking advantage of even God when we don't give God what he deserves. That's what Lent is all about. It's taking a look at our sins in an honest way, right? Even our sin of stealing, and confessing it, admitting it, and taking responsibility for it, and stop denying that we are, you know, living, you know, denying that this type of living is a way that is acceptable. You know, we don't want to be like the man who had a nagging secret, and what he did is kept it hidden for a long, long time until he finally went to his priest to confess it. He admitted that for years he had been stealing supplies from the lumber yard where he had worked. "How much lumber did you take?" the priest asked. "Well, I took enough," he said, "to build my home and enough for my son's home." Thinking he was done, the priest started to speak, but the man interrupted him. "Then I took enough to build houses for my two daughters. Oh, and I took enough lumber to build our cottage on the lake." The priest said, "This is a very serious offense. I'm going to have to think of a far-reaching penance for you. Have you ever considered doing a retreat?" "No, Father, I never have," the man replied. "But if you can get the plans for the retreat, I can get the lumber to build it." Let me repeat this. What Lent is about is looking at our sin is sin, and to stop it. To confess it to God, to know that we are forgiven by God, and to deny living this way as we go forward in the future. Because when you and I are forgiven, what does God give us? He gives us a chance to live in a new way. So let me finish with this. There were two brothers who were caught stealing sheep. And for their crime in this village, they were each branded on the forehead with the letters ST, branded right on their forehead, these two brothers, sheep thief. Well, one brother immediately ran away, and he attempted to build a new life in another country. But even there, people constantly asked him what the ST that was burned on his forehead, what it meant. And so he continued his wandering, and finally, unable to bear the burden, it was told that he had a mental breakdown and that he had even attempted to take his own life. The other brother, though, took a different approach. He said to himself, "I can't run away from the fact that I stole sheep, but that's the past. I can stay here now and win back my self-respect and the respect of my neighbors." So the years passed, and he built then a reputation day by day, week by week, year by year, a reputation of integrity. One day, a stranger saw this brother walking through town with the letter ST branded on his forehead, and he asked the resident of the town what the letters stood for. The resident of the town replied, "Well, it happened a long time ago, and I've really forgotten the particulars, but I think the letters ST are an abbreviation for saint." You see, whatever our story is in the past, when it comes to our sin, you see, the story of our past can be changed to a different story of the future, especially if it has anything to do with, even like we've talked about, with stealing. God gives us a chance to have a future of integrity, a future that's new, and to leave the past behind. When I was 6 years of age and I got home from that trip not allowing to have any candy, my father asked me if I had learned my lesson. And that 5.5 to 6 hour trip home from my granddad's store had taught me a very important lesson. I was very sorry for what I had done. I knew that, what, even as a 6-year-old child, that I wanted to be forgiven for it. And as I walked into the house, my dad then came to me and said, "Here." And he gave me my bag of candy. My granddad, unbeknownst to me, had filled a bag for me and then said to my dad, "When you think he's learned his lesson, let him know that I still love him and that the candy is his." God does the same thing for us. We sin. Hopefully we can be honest about that. Hopefully we can be sorrowful. Hopefully we can ask for forgiveness. And when we do, we know we have a God of grace bringing us his love again. Amen.
Hey, thanks for watching. Trinity Lutheran Church can be found at 1100 Philadelphia Road in Joppa, Maryland. You can also find us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. If you like this video, go ahead and click the like button. That's a thumbs up button right here on the YouTube page. And you could also be a big help to us if you go ahead and subscribe to our YouTube channel. Thank you very much, and God bless.